We're trying to just get people to like see our YouTube to be honest, like look at all the other lectures as well.
Oh, no, no, no.
They've reduced the point of
those just being called. It is possible to put videos on while we read, but it requires interacting with other people for us putting them on YouTube back into students.
YouTube's
doing
great.
Yeah, I'm not on the notes of people hearing me talking about the fact that I recorded Friday's lecture. At least some one person said by email I was helpful. Was that one of you guys or? No, okay. If it is actually helpful to anyone, it would actually be helpful to me in the math department generally, if you say so, because we're sort of conducting a big giant fight at the university to get boards recorded in places. And they're starting to set it up in some rooms, but the university says it to spend all the money. So even having students say, yes, having video of the board is really helpful, will help us make things happen. Even like comments on the YouTube video, comments on Waddle, send me an email, anything like that, you can use it as ammunition. Pop up camera to one. Yeah, absolutely.
Because, like, I think at this point, a lot of us are sort of used to.
Yeah, no, I'm not used to.
Yeah,
this semester is teaching algebra 1 and rather has the board recording teaching. Yeah, we are very prioritizing the more important courses. But it would be nice if we all.
Oh, yeah, no, sorry, that is something
that's
happening on about it.
So where are we up to? We spent I guess the big point from last time was that bounded is the same thing as continuous for maps between Hilbert spaces. We proved that one time theory talked about linear functionals, maps from a Hilbert space to complex numbers, but then I think we talked about it in the general case. Exception in place on the proof in the one-dimensional case. There was one thing that I skipped over while talking about this stuff, which is pretty important. So I might have to go back and say one thing here. So remember, we had the definition of the norm of a linear operator. Someone going to tell me what the norm of a linear operator is?
The infimum of all the bounds over, like, so if you had T,
so it's the least upper bound for the operator, where m is an upper bound in this sense. If norm is the smallest m, the infimum of m, so that's true. But there's a nice formula that is sometimes helpful, that this is the supremum over vectors f and g of the absolute value of t applied to f, the inner product of t applied to f and g, and here we need to quantify over a pair of vectors of norm 1. You could obviously tweak this to put just the supremum over arbitrary vectors, and you'd have to normalize both by the, you'd have to normalize this by dividing by the norm of it. Okay. So that one's just, so that's just the definition, and the lemma is this equation. Prove this, or prove it to you guys. One direction is really easy. Maybe work out what this direction is. One hopefully just follows direction. Yep.
When f is g.
When f is g,
yeah.
What about when f is g?
Then I'm guessing that it's easy to prove that the definition is greater than or equal to that supremum.
Yeah, I mean, I think, I don't think you even need to do that. I mean, so let's write half of the proof, at least. the norm of TFG, well, the only thing we can possibly do is apply pressure shorts. Okay? So it's bounded by the norm of TF times the norm of G, and that's bounded by the norm of T times the norm of F times the norm of G. And we were assuming here that F and G were equipped with the norm 1. So we did that really easily by Cauchy Schwarz. The other direction is maybe a little bit hard. One thing, I think I want to get onto the combat operator stuff. So let's leave it as an exercise. It's in the notes if you want to see it. But I want you to think about the other direction, which is ever so slightly. One thing I want you to be careful of here is that this is not equal to, in general, the supremum of just this one. Okay? That I'm getting the answer wrong. Obviously, what's the inequality between these two supremum? One is, hopefully, this one is bigger than that one because we're taking the supremum over a bigger set. The F and G don't need to be equal. And in the exercise, it's fine to count it. That is, where this quantity doesn't compute the norm for you, it computes something strictly smaller than the norm. And the clue is just that you don't do work very hard. Two-dimensional normal space, and T just being some 2x2 matrix will work fine. So when I say find a counterexample, I mean like write down an explicit 2x2 matrix so that you can calculate this right hand side and see that it's not right. Okay, what other things do we need to know about this stuff? So another thing that we didn't talk about last time, but maybe we should add, is adjoints. So, so if you have T, and that between two Hilbert spaces, so maybe unconventional letters to the Hilbert space, so it's about it in that. Star, usually where this is just T adjoint, it goes back the other way. Well, to be a unique operator, satisfying the following condition that I look at the inner product of TF with G, so here F is in the domain of T, so F is in U, and G is in the codomain of T, so G is in V. It is the same as T star. Okay, let's see what should we say about this. So the first exercise is that this actually exists. So how would you do this? How would you show that such an operator exists? What do we mean by define it by that? So if I tell you, I mean, if I give you some G and V, you've just got to tell me what T star G is, and show me some vector. So it's not enough to say define it by this.
If T is bijective, then we can like automatically this.
Yeah, but A bounded linear map. We're defining adjoints for just anything, whether they're injective, bijective, whatever. Not neither injective nor surjective. bedroom is just always there. I mean, the pre-exercise is there is at most one such operator. That is, this pins down exactly what T-star is meant to be. So let's just check that. So say we had T-star and T5-pointed star that both satisfy that formula, okay? Then what could we say? Well, for all G and F, we'd have that F, comma, T-star minus T5-pointed star of G equals zero, okay? So they both have the right-hand side, they're both going to be adjoints to T. But that tells you, since the inner product of this vector with all Fs is zero, that tells you that T star minus T5-pointed star of G is zero for all G, and that's exactly saying that these operators are equal. Okay, so there's at most one adjoint, but we've got to see that we can actually build one that follows this rule. Let's get our hands dirty. What would I mean by get our hands dirty? What do we know we can do with any old orbit space? We can. We can pick an orthonormal basis, yeah. And as soon as you pick an orthonormal basis, it's not so hard to see what we need. So, pick EI an orthonormal basis for B, and FI. Which I'm not really sure we even need to pick a further one, but let's. While we're in for a penny, in for a pound, let's pick the basis for both. Okay, so now what does this tell you? Well, this formula, or maybe what I should say is then, we know that T star of EI, well, we're meant to get some vector in U, and we can write all vectors in U as linear combinations. So we must be able to write this like this. For some aij complex numbers. Okay, we have to be able to do that. Now, once we've decided these, so once we've picked aij, t is completely determined. So this is an important principle. Once you know what a linear operator does on every element of an orthonormal basis, you know what it does on the finite linear combinations, and by continuity, you know what it does on the whole Hilbert space, because everything is a limit of finite linear combinations, because the finite linear combinations are dense. So our job is just to construct it, our job is just to pick the AIJs and then to check that this is actually a bounded operator. We know what this formula just directly tells you what the AIJs should be. Okay? So take F equals Fj, G equals EI, and this star is a very bad name for an equation that's talking about G star. So in there, and it just tells you that Aij bar equals T. Left-hand side of that equation, on the right-hand side, I'm just using the fact that I know what T star of EI is, and I'm using the fact that, maybe let me write that out so people can see. That's Fj T star Gi, which is Fj sum Aij Fj. Only one term survives here, if they fix out exactly one term, and we use linearity, anti-linearity in the second argument. See, let's say I actually okay. So we've got a proposal now. We know that if it's possible to find T star, it's got to work like this, okay? So T star of E I must equal sum of what was it, this quantity with a bar over it. But then you remember bar just swaps the order of your product, so let's just write it that way. Are we done? Have we constructed the adjunct? Still got one really thing we're meant to prove before this counts as constructing the adjunct. What's that? So what have we done at this point? We've defined something, we've defined T star on a basis, and everything's either a linear combination of the basis elements or it's unlimited things. So we know what T star will do to everything. Oh, this one, well, the thing we basically need to check is that this formula really is defining a bounded linear operator. I mean, if I just tell you, here's what some linear map does for a whole lot of basis elements, there's no reason that has to define a bounded linear map. It could just be discontinuous, okay? I mean, if I just told you a map, like DEI equals I times EI, just takes each basis vector and scales it up by I, obviously that's not going to be a bounded linear map. It will be space for itself. So things can go horribly wrong because we're defining things on a basis. So to finish this, we need to see that that formula there hearing you.
Parseval's equation and then Cauchy's one.
Yes, yeah. So it's not that hard from here. I think I will actually leave it to get another exercise. And the hint is exactly what you suggested. Parseval and Cauchy Schwarz will get you those final steps of the way. You're allowed to complain if I give too many exercises in class. Try and do them, because they're some of the juicy bits. Okay, so we have adjuncts. Nearly always you just end up using this equation, not actually caring about this gory detail of how they're defined on basis elements, because that's a bit out of the pre-basis elements. Okay, I guess the notes actually don't have any of this discussion here. They just say, exercise, go from there. If anyone wants more help on this bit, feel free to ask us. To finish off section two, we need to say a few more things about what projections are and what unitaries are. So P, a map from an ordered space to itself, is a projection. Squared equals P, and an orthogonal projection also P equals P star. So that condition there we say self-adjoint. Okay? If an operator is equal to its adjoint, it's called a self-adjoint operator. And we'll meet those a whole lot of the time. So what are these meant to be? Well, finite dimensional linear algebra, what would this condition say? It's just some map that when you do it twice, it's the same as doing it once, which is exactly just projecting onto a subspace. So you should think here that maybe in finite dimensions, this is as if you've written H as some subspace directs out another subspace, and you're just throwing out one of the components and keeping the gets everything down onto some subspace. And orthogonal, well, which is written very algebraically, is this condition. But it's a good exercise to stop and think about what it means geometrically in small dimensions. For example, in two dimensions, it's then a projection where the bit that we're throwing out, that is the kernel of P, is orthogonal to the space that we're projecting onto. That's maybe not really explicit when you see it there, but that's what ends up being. So some important consequences here. Let's see. So orthogonal to the range of the identity minus P. Okay. Moreover, we can do a little calculation that shows that in a second. Moreover, I guess a few things. I minus P is also an orthogonal projection. Subspaces. Maybe another thing to say is conversely, if S is a closed subspace, remember we decided that we can write S, we can write a whole Hilbert space then as the direct sum of that closed subspace and its orthogonal complement. Some f written in a unique way as something in here plus something in here, the maps that send f to the piece in S or the piece in T are both orthogonal projections. So all of this together is just telling you that orthogonal projections correspond one-to-one with closed subspaces. Okay, where if you take a projection P, you get a closed subspace from it by taking its range. And conversely, if you've got a closed subspace, you write your Hilbert space like this, and then take the projection that takes a vector and picks out a piece of it. So really, they're actually just something we've talked about before, but in this more algebraic set. So maybe what's the interesting bit of this that deserves proving is maybe actually just this first statement that the range of P is orthogonal to the range of 1 minus P. Because hopefully in that we can see both how the definition of adjoints works and why it's necessary for this to be true. I mean, notice here, back at these examples, if we were looking at just a projection, not an orthogonal projection, we might have had the range of P was here, but if you calculate what the range of 1 minus P is, it's going to be some subspace that's at some point. Okay, so what are we going to do? So we're going to say, what do we need to do? We need to calculate PF inner product I minus PG. And our goal is to prove that this is, if we're trying to, prove that this is zero. This is an arbitrary element of the range of P, and this is an arbitrary element of the range of I minus P. we just kind of showed that those subspaces are always orthogonal. And so it's pretty easy here. You just use the fact that P is idempotent, P squared is equal to P, to give yourself an extra copy of P there. And then you use the fact that, well, we don't actually don't use any fact at all. Just use the equation defining an adjoint to move P across to the other side of this inner product. And we've just argued that there's always a P star that you can always do that. But now we use the fact that P equals P star. And then you expand everything out. We get PG minus P squared G. And of course we're almost done now, because P squared is the same as P. Curious note, maybe I shouldn't bother saying this. How many people in the room have seen the idea of an adjoint functor? No, a handful. More than a handful. Okay, great. I mean, everyone who hasn't done any kind of review can ignore this. The thing that defines an adjoint pair of functors is that you have this natural isomorphism between the following two Hom spaces where f and g are the adjoint pair. And notice this is almost exactly the same as the equation defining an adjoint linear transformation. You just erase the word Hom in front, and you've really got it. Does anyone want to take any guesses as to which term derives from which term? Which is the older one, and which is the newer one? Yes, categories. This stuff is ancient. We're barely going to get into the 20th century. That's enough about projections for now. We'll have more later. Unitaries. So U, a map from a Hilbert space to, I guess, another Hilbert space, is unitary. If U star equals U inverse, okay? Most maps between Hilbert spaces, of course, don't have inverses at all. So this is asserting that U has an inverse, and U star is equal to that inverse. Okay? So these are the right notion of equivalences between Hilbert spaces. And the reason for that is that they're exactly the notion that basically, just because if I look at UF, UG, well, by using adjoints, I can move one of the U's across. I can rewrite that as the inverse, and then I can dictate a U inverse. Okay? So they're maps where it doesn't matter whether you take the inner product of two vectors in the first order space, or shove them both over into the other Hilbert space using unit and then calculate the inner product there. Another way of saying that is that unitaries are exactly maps between Hilbert spaces that preserve the inner products. Okay? So that's why they're the right notion of equivalence. Final little lemma that we talked about before, any two separable infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces are unitarily equivalent. By unitarily equivalent, I just mean that there exists some unitary from one Hilbert space to another. And I've only left myself this amount of room, so the proof must be pretty dull. How does the proof go? That's all we can do, basically. Pick orthonormal bases and just define that U of EI is FI, the corresponding basis element over the other Hilbert space. And you can check very easily, in fact, by the formula that we erased, if you wanted to, that the adjoint of this view just takes f out of the EI, and so it's pretty easy to see that. But that's also the inverse. So this is the unitary. Just so everyone, make sure everyone's on the ball. What would go wrong if I erased either that word or that word?
You'll take
infinite. You'll take infinite for 500 points.
So. Yeah. So if something, like say, if you have a 100 base set, let's say 3-dimensional, and it's 5-dimensional, you sort of run out of basic vectors.
Yeah, exactly. This wouldn't actually.
Pass it out.
Yeah, we need to, for this argument to work, the two bases have to have the same cardinality for this to actually define an invertible map. Separable?
Yeah, we can't get an orthogonal basis.
Exactly. Our theorem promising an orthogonal basis uses that dense set, and then we actually move so on.
There's a theorem that says that you can always complete it to a bigger space. If you have a non-separable orthogonal space, you can make it separable by adding more points. That's inside of Chakashi. You can complete it.
You can make a non-separable Hilbert space separate.
I think he's saying you have a pre-Hilbert space.
Yeah.
What's the talk about that one? Maybe I'm very confused about that possibly.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm curious. Well, let's. Remind me in half an hour. Okay. Is everyone happy up to date? Any questions? Okay. So I think that gets rid of section two for us. And we can try and squeeze in a little bit about compact operators today. So what's the point of we're going to define these things called compact operators, which are a nice special class of all bound linear transformations. The reason for studying them is sort of twofold. One, they're easy, so we can say a lot about them. They behave much, much more like linear maps between finite dimensional vector spaces than the general case of bounded linear transformations between infinite dimensional vector spaces. But secondly, they're still pretty useful, even though they're a very special case. So the first thing to see is that observe the unit ball in H is non-compact. Closed unit ball. I think that all the stuff with norm at most one. And that's very sad because we're used to thinking from finite dimensional worlds that closed bounded sets in Rn, say, are compact. And this is great for that. So what's the observation? Why does this work? Why is it non-compact? Yep, yeah, take basis vectors, yeah, exactly. The distance between Ei and Ej is always exactly the square root 2. So that gives you some sequence of vectors, and there's no possible convergence subsequence. Any subsequence of points is still all exactly distance 2 above. Okay. So we say t from h to h, although this works fine for two different Hilbert spaces, is compact. So it takes this probably non-compact unit ball over here and squashes it down to something much smaller that is compact over here. So let's have some examples. Someone tell me something that is compact?
Point set.
What's that?
Point set.
A point? Oh, no, an operator. I want an operator that's compact.
Okay, so
there will be zero.
Yeah, exactly. T equals zero. The image of the unit ball is just a singleton point zero, and that's certainly compact. Yep. So T equals the projection onto E1 through EN. Yeah. So the image here, the image of the unit ball in this infinite dimensional Hilbert space is just going to be, it'll actually, I think, just be the unit ball of this n-dimensional Hilbert space. Okay? And the closed unit ball in C to the N is a compact set. And so then ever so slightly more generally, T is a finite rank operator. Which just means what? So what does rank usually mean? Rank is the dimension of the image of the thing. So finite rank just means it's a linear map with finite dimensional image. Then I think it's the right moment that we can just start proving the wonderful theorem that let's see. The compact operators are closed in norm topology. That's part one of the theorem. Part two is every compact operator. Norm limit of finite rank operators. So this is kind of cool. So what does this first statement even mean? To be closed in a norm topology. We haven't really explicitly said this. Someone else want to? Yeah, another way of thinking about it is just that V of H, all the bounded linear operators on some Hilbert space, acquires a metric. That is, we can think of it as a metric space by the distance from one operator to another is the norm of the difference of those two operators. Okay. So just like this is a little confusing, the Hilbert space is a Hilbert space with an inner product, and its norm comes from the inner product. All of B of H is not a Hilbert space. Okay, it's got a nice norm, by operator norm. Okay, but it's a different sort of gap than the underlying Hilbert space itself. And so when we say that some set, so we can say S in B of H is norm closed. Just means that it's closed with respect to the topology of this metric, i.e., if we have some sequence that's in S, and Tn converges in norm to T in B of H, then actually T is in S2. Okay? So this is the sort of thing we're saying about compact operators, that if you take a limit of compact operators, you might think you just get some bounded operator, but actually it's always going to be compact as well. That's the first part. And the second part is that every compact operator is a norm limit of finite rank operators. That is, if you take an arbitrary compact operator, we can find some sequence of finite rank operators that are approaching it in this norm topology. So another way of saying all of this is that compact operators the norm closure of the finite rank operators. And this is really the explanation for why they're pretty easy. They're not that far from being finite rank operators themselves. Okay, which bit do we want to prove first? Both of them are going to nice. So I guess let's do the first part first. So what do we need to do? So say we have Ti compact ti converges to some t b of h, and that's converges in the norm topology. I'm going to, at this point, stop adding norm over convergences. We'll discover soon, and on the assignment and so on, that there are lots of different topologies on the space of all operators. There's the norm topology, there's the strong topology, there's the weak topology, and there are 17 other topologies. The norm one is in some sense sort of the default one. If people don't specify, they mean the norm one, so I'll stop writing norm. But just be aware there are others. So we need to show T is compact. And how do you actually show something is compact in a metric space? Typically, you show that in the image, if you have a some sequence in the image, you pick some conversion subsequence. Okay. So we'll show. Sequence fi in the Hilbert space, the sequence tfi has a convergent subsequence. Sorry. This is wrong. So can someone tell me what's wrong about that? Either say fi, we should maybe say the rate sequence in the uniform. Because, of course, if not the image of all of H, it's meant to be compact. That would leave us with very few examples. It's the image of the uniform that's meant to be compact. Are people happy with if this is what we need to prove? So we'll use the diagonal argument. Okay. So let's look at the sequence T1 of the Fi. So T1 being the very first guy in this sequence of compact operators. What can we say about this? It's got a convergent subsequence. Yeah, great. Yep. Yep. So it has some convergent subsequence. And so let's call that F subscript 1, comma K. K is the natural number. Okay? And so then we'll look at T2. And we're not going to go back and look at T2 applied to the FIs, because that would throw away what we already learned. Let's look at T2 applied to F1i. Okay, that's also got some convergent subsequence. And we'll call that one F2k, and so on. Okay? So we're taking sparser and sparser subsequences as we go out of our original sequence. Okay. So define gk to be fkk. The kth element of the kth subsequence that we took along the way. And now we're going to claim that T applied to this GK converges. So how on earth can we prove our job is to show that TGK minus TGL. Our job is to show this gets really small. So this is the maybe I'll even say this. It suffices to prove it is Cauchy, because of course we're in a Hilbert space. So it's complete. So we don't have to mess about guessing what the limit is, we just need to show that the sequence is always Cauchy. So this is the thing we need to show is zero. And what's the sort of a, I think a fairly natural first step to try and control the this guy. So what we can do is we can say, well, instead of getting directly from TGK to TGL, what we can do is we can go over here to TMGK, and then we can jump across to TMGL and then jump back. Okay? And so what we're just going to use the square inequality to see that this is TGK minus TMGK plus TMGK minus TMGL plus TMGL minus TGL. And as soon as you've done that, things start looking a little bit better. Why do things look a little bit better? Some of the claims, some of those terms are now easy to deal with. And so, which are the easy terms to deal with?
So the top and bottom.
Yeah. So the first one, what's happening is we're changing from T to TN, but the argument is staying exactly the same. So what we can do is we can say that TGK minus TMGK is bounded just by the definition of an operator norm, by the norm of T minus TM times the norm of GK. These GKs, remember, weren't so bad. They're elements of these crazy subsequences of subsequences. So in particular, they're all just elements of Fi. So they're all in the unit board. So that bit's at most one. And what can we say here?
Exactly.
So we can make this as small as we like, but not convergence. So pick M large enough. So this is small. Similarly for the other term as well. And all that we need to do is show that this bit is small. So Y is TMGK minus TMGL. With the G's and K's in it, is not necessarily the whole sequence GK is not a subsequence of what do we call it? F K comma I, where I is the variable. Okay? You gotta be a little bit careful. Eventually it is, but it's not, it might not be at first.
Sorry, do you want M I or am I
Oh, yeah, sorry, absolutely. Yep, great, thank you. Yep. This sequence, the GK that we're actually looking at, is not necessarily a subsequence of this fixed MI, but only for a really stupid reason, just that the K is less than M, could be off in bigger sequences. You know that these FMIs, as M increases, these are getting sparser and sparser sequences. The problem is just the early ones might not be in there. But we can say, but eventually, G, this is in here. That is, you might have to throw away some finite initial string of these guys. But that's fine. That still lets you conclude that this is a converging subsequence. It doesn't matter what happens on some initial bit of the GKs. For fixed M, TMGK is a converging sequence. Okay? And everything is small without. I even managed to do that without writing epsilon. Okay. Great. Let's see if we can squeeze in part two as well. I know Mondays, this lecture turns directly into the tutorial hour, which makes it very tempting for me to run over time on Mondays. I will try and resist doing that too badly, but I probably won't resist in time. Okay, so let's see if we can see the second element. How are we meant to do this? We've got some compact operator, and we're meant to come up with some sequence of finite rank operators, and then try and show that it's a norm of those guys. How on earth can we do that? Where do these finite rank operators come from? One way to do it is we can pick a normal basis. We define Qn to be the projection under the first n basis vectors. Okay. Then Qnt in the unfortunate recently. I've run into all sorts of notational difficulties, and I've come to believe that function composition should be written the other way around when all mathematicians write. And so, to me, it's just terrible that this means do t first and then do qn, and then do qn. And if you ever find me writing functions in the wrong order, just forgive me. It also, I also start wanting to write this for the function if applied to x, because that's obviously what you're meant to do. But anyway, the point is, these guys are all finite rank. And they couldn't not be integers always in the first and the basis vectors. And so our job is to just show that these work. Q and T's converge T. Okay, so this is kind of messy. So the thing we want to do, I've also made life really difficult by changing notation to the notes, so let's quickly fix that. Let's call these p's. The notes use q for 1 minus p. Okay, so suppose, for the sake of getting a contradiction, and if anyone wants to make me happy, they can come up with a version of this argument that doesn't use contradiction, because amongst my other recent mathematical difficulties, I've decided I don't quite like the law of the excluded middle, and don't quite really prove the contradiction anymore. But in any case, suppose for contradiction that we have this not happening. These norms are not converging to zero. So what can you do if you have some sequence of numbers not converging to zero? Well, notice these are always norms of positive numbers. Okay? So saying they don't converge to zero means what?
You can use an epsilon over.
Yeah. So this means there is some epsilon and some n i's, so that p subscript n subscript I composed of t minus t is bigger than epsilon. Okay, now what is that telling us? Saying that the norm of some operator is at least epsilon. We just want to unfold the definition of the norm. That says, thus, there is some unit vector fi, so that the norm of p n I t fi minus t fi is at least, am I allowed to write epsilon there? Why can't I write
epsilon? Epsilon magnitude fi.
Sorry?
Epsilon
Oh, I see. So I said unit vector, so that's not the issue. Yeah, I think we're fine. Okay. The thing, I was worried that I had to write like an epsilon over 2 or something, but it's okay because we've said that this norm is strictly bigger than epsilon, so we've already given ourselves a bit of room. Okay, good. So we can do that. And now our job is to, from this fact, try and get some luggage. So how does that go? The proof in the notes, this was when I was misled by following the proof in the notes in my head, but doing something better on the board. The proof in the notes puts a greater than or equal to here, and then has to put it at epsilon over 2 here, which seems pretty simple to me. Greater than epsilon works fine. Okay. Well, what do you do here? So we've got this sequence fi, and so the only thing we can really do is by compactness of t, we can see that there's a subsequence f I j, so t f I j converts to g for some g. And then I think it's pretty easy from there. So we just look at all of this on that subsequence. So we have P, N, I, J, it's getting to be a lot of subscripts. T, F, I, J, minus T, F, I, J. And what on earth can we do with that? So we're using the fact that that's conversion. So let's just wrap this. So the Fij is going to g, so let's just wrap here. Minus g plus g minus t Fij. Okay? And then we use the triangle inequality to split this up. This bit is something that's certainly going to be zero. And we have to worry about this first one. And why? Someone sees how this last step goes. We'll get the contradiction by showing also this goes to zero, okay, which shows that this is really small contradicting that. So why is that going to zero? This one. Yeah, this is definitely going to help right now. Okay. So, this bit here.
P and I, J, G on the right side. You got a G on the right side.
Is it, sorry, left it for you? Yep.
And then
do another triangle and call it either P and I, J, T, F, I, J.
I think that point's fine.
That's
converted to zero.
This is
I found
normal
P and I, J is 1.
So, okay, so this bit here, great. Okay, so that's P Yep, good.
Yeah.
That argument there works. Okay. And we know that bit's going to be zero. But now we're going to deal with this one. Okay, now that's going to work fine. That's going to zero just because we assumed that was converging. And this bit is going to zero because this is picking up more and more of the initial chunks of G, and so those initial chunks of G are converging to G. Okay, sorry, I screwed that up there at the end. Okay, sorry about running over time. Let's take a few minutes to do whatever you like. Go to the toilet, escape, not come back if you don't want to. But please do, because the tutorial is hopefully really useful. And in a few minutes we can talk about any combination of the problem set, the assignment, and things that have gone wrong.
What's the problem set online?
The problem set is online. Did everyone? Did other people find it?
Yeah, okay.
So it's on the Waddle page. Scroll down for a bit. It's eventually there. Was this before it uses that much?